evening, everyone. My name is Taylor Adams, and I am the president of the Young Americans for Freedom chapter here at Clemson. First, I would like to start by thanking each and every one of you for being here with us tonight, part of the Young America's Foundation's Preserving American Liberty in Lecture Series. I would also like to thank the Clemson University Police Department for ensuring our safety and the Clemson administration for their support. Specifically, I would like to thank Dr. Miller, our Vice President of Student Affairs, and Dr. Smith, our Senior Associate Vice President of Student Affairs. We are so grateful to have leaders in our administration like Dr. Smith and Dr. Miller who continuously defend our First Amendment rights as college students. Thank you both for being here. Events like these would not be possible without you. Thank you also to the Young Americas Foundation for supporting our chapter and providing us with the tools and resources to host an event of this nature. Lastly, I would like to extend a special thank you to Mr. Keith Work for his steadfast support in helping to make this event possible. Finally, a little bit about who you came to see tonight. Yeonmi Park grew up in Haesan, North Korea, during which time it was normal for her to see dead bodies as she walked to school and to be so hungry that she ate plants and bugs from the woods. It wasn't until watching a pirated copy of the Titanic that Ms. Park saw the veil of tyranny begin to fall. Having caught a glimpse of the free world, Park realized that her experience of life wasn't the only one, and that she might one day find a way out. In 2002, Park's father was arrested and sent to a prison camp for engaging in illegal trading. In 2007, Park's sister escaped with a friend before she and her mother followed her to China. However, before they could locate her sister, Park and her mother were sold separately to Chinese human traffickers. In 2009, Park and her mother crossed the Gobi Desert to Mongolia from China, enduring the harsh climate until eventually finding freedom in South Korea. She recounts this incredible story in her memoir, In Order to Live, A North Korean Girl's Journey to Freedom, and in her moving lectures in which she describes these experiences. An insightful and inspirational speaker, Ms. Park is quickly becoming one of the leading human rights activists in the world and a leading voice for those who are oppressed. Ladies and gentlemen, it is an honor and a privilege to introduce to you Ms. Yeonmi Park.
Oh, good evening, everyone. I feel so lucky to be here and so grateful to be here talking to you. I was in the green room and thinking about what can I share with the people coming here today. And I was thinking, lately, I became quite a controversial figure in America because I said things like, I love America. America is awesome. And a lot of people don't understand how can you think that way. And I think that really explains why how many Americans have no idea how great they really have here. Growing up in North Korea, guys, every single day, I had to call you guys bastards. American bastards. Even in my math class, I had to solve a math problem like this. There are 4 American bastards, you killed 2 of them. How many American bastards left to kill? And that was my education. And if any of you right now here go to North Korea, try to share your life story, what do you think is going to happen? You are going to be executed, no doubt. However, in America, right now, coming from North Korea, I'm able to have a voice and share my life story. That tolerance, that freedom, that's why I fell in love with America. And that's why I'm ready to die for this country. I was born in the darkest part of our world, in a way. If you guys seen the picture of North Korea at nighttime, the satellite pictures, has any of you seen that? It is the darkest place in the world. North Koreans have no idea there is even something called internet exists. Growing up in North Korea, the first thing I learned from my own mother was, don't even whisper. She said, birds and mice could hear me. If I said one wrong word, it was going to not just kill my life, it was going to kill 3 to 8 generations of my life, my family's life. And that's how what you say, what you think is completely controlled by the Kim dictatorship. I'm sure a lot of you guys seen the picture of Kim Jong-un, right? And his funny haircut. For us, it's almost a joke. Because we live in a free world, we can make fun of dictator, and there are no consequences for that. But in North Korea, instead of making fun of them, every single morning I woke up, the first thing that I had to say was not good morning to my parents or my sister. I had to go by in front of the portraits that we had in our room. Every single room, train, every room required to have the portraits of Kim dictators in North Korea. It's like 1984 in the book, the big brother is watching you all the time. And in the middle of night, you never know. A police officer can kick your door and come into your home and then bring the whitest cloth and then gonna swipe that portrait. If a single dust gathered on those portraits, that's how you end up executed in North Korea. Nobody is a human being in that country. You are all called revolutionaries. Every single day I go to school, I learned about the greatness of the dictator. In a way, think about the North Korean regime like a religion. North Korean regime copied the Bible, and they brainwashed North Korean people like they are God. So Kim Il-sung said, "I'm a God, I love you guys so much, I'm giving you my son Kim Jong-il. His body dies, but his spirit is with you, and that's how he even knows what you think in your head. So you are not even free to think. And there's no outside information. There's one channel on TV. There's no independent media. Where do you get the facts?" So that's how I believed growing up in North Korea, thought Americans were monsters, and I was lucky to be living in a socialist paradise where I had the greatest leader in the whole world. Despite my loyalty to the government, the daily life was struggle to find food. As you can see in my body, most of North Koreans' bodies are marked from the nutrition that we malnutrition that we experience when you're little kids. Every single day, my job was finding food. And the fanciest thing that I ate in North Korea were grasshoppers and dragonflies. I just used a lighter and the roast its head, and I would eat them. And so many people in America right now, I hear from the elites in New York talking about, you know, the climate change and how we need to eat bugs, how it's good for climate change. I was like, no way. I've ate it, it's my own portion. They taste horrible. I prefer steak anytime, any day, any moment. But I had no option in North Korea. I had to eat these, and these were the only source of protein I could get as a child. By the time I was 13 years old, it was 2007. I hope a lot of you were born at the time. it came to a point where we could not find food. We had to do something. But what do we do? It's not like I had the information looking at the map of the world. I've never even seen map of the world. Do you guys know that North Korea is like almost a different planet? North Korean calendar begins when Kim Il-sung was born. Right now is a Juche year 118 for North Koreans. North Koreans, the regime does not even teach its own people that they are Asians. They said, "You are our dear leader's race," which is called the Kim Il-sung race. They have a different time zone. So I had no idea the world like this, diverse, different continents, different race even existed. I just thought, well, I was in the center of the universe, and maybe there are American ambassadors, and maybe maximum China and South Korea. That's all I thought about the world. Luckily, I lived in the border town of North Korea. I was able to see the lights coming from there at nighttime. And I saw the highways for the first time on Chinese side where the cars are running by. In North Korea, the 97% of roads are not paved. I've never seen the car like here I see. And that's when I thought, maybe if I go where the lights are, I could find a bowl of rice. And that simple curiosity led me to escape from North Korea. And it's in a way it's embarrassing because a lot of people tell me, "You're so brave, you fought for freedom." And I was like, When I was in North Korea, I did not even know that was a word. North Korea is just not lack of food and things. It's also lack of a lot of concepts that we take for granted in the free world. Just like the concepts like love, human rights, liberty, freedom doesn't exist. It's literally a reality version of 1984. They do have a double speak. And the reason why the regime got rid of these words, like even the word gay, they don't have. The reason they don't have those words is that if you don't know the word, that means you don't understand the concept. That's how government can control what you think. So my simple just curiosity was, maybe China might have a bowl of rice for me if I go there. In order to do that, I had to cross that frozen river, Yalu River, into China. But I couldn't go because I got really, really sick. And my sister, who was at the time 16, left me a note, and she escaped first. Because I was sick, my mother took me to a hospital. And it's a socialist healthcare system where everything is free, right? When I got to the hospital, I saw the nurse was using one needle to inject every patient. In North Korea, nobody dies from cancer. I've never heard such a case because before cancer kills you, everything else is gonna come get you. And usually it's an infection and malnutrition. In this hospital, the doctors rubbed my tummy that afternoon and they realized, they thought I had some appendicitis. They opened me up while I'm awake and they realized I just had were malnourished and had an infection. They got still embarrassed to my parents, so they still removed my fine appendix and they stitched me back up. So don't worry, I'm gonna sue these doctors when I go back to North Korea. After this operation, the last thing I saw from my home country called North Korea was piled of dead bodies scattered there. And it's not my first time seeing dead people, because in North Korea, seeing dead people is like looking at trees. It's that common. But this thing made me surprised was because it's people who are dead and gathered, like scattered around, the people who didn't have eyes. Their eyes were hollow. And I asked my mother, like, why don't they have eyes? And she said, the eyes are the soft tissue in our body. When we die, rats eat our eyes first. And that's when I thought, this is a living hell. After I got discharged from the hospital, I found a note that my sister left me. And then we found a lady who was willing to help us to cross the river to China. I had no idea what was waiting for me in China because there's no way I could know because there's no newspapers. Luckily, this lady bribed the border guards. And North Korean borders are not like American borders. You can just walk in if you want to. There are border guards with machine guns. They're gonna shoot you. They're not gonna even bother to tell you stop there. They're gonna just shoot to kill order. The lady who was helping us bribed these border guards. And that's how we were able to not get shot and cross the frozen river into China in March 20th, when I was 13 years old in 2007. As soon as I got to Chinese side, the very first thing that I heard was, I wanted to have sex with her. The people who were receiving us were human traffickers in China, and he said this to my mother. In North Korea, I never knew what sex education was, so I had no idea what that meant. Turns out, China were buying North Korean women as sex bribes. So you guys all know that China had a one-child policy, right? This policy resulted in so many people aborting girls and kept the boys only. So now, in China, 33 million men, guys, cannot find wives. So what do? So that's when they buy North Korean women as their sex slaves. after this man who raped my mom, and they took me to a somewhere called a safe house in China. And they checked my teeth, and they checked my body, and they started negotiating my price. And turns out they decided to sell my mom for over $65, and they decided to charge me for over $200. I asked this person, like, why am I more expensive than my mom? Because she was like twice of my size at the time. And they said, oh, you're more expensive than your mom because you're a child virgin, and a lot of men in China love to take the child virginity away. So that's why you're more valuable than your mom. And that's how I was separated from my mom, and I became a sex slave. When I separated from my mom, I was sold to another human trafficker who bought me. And when he was trying to rape me for the first time, I was like killing myself because I lost everything that I cared about, which was my family. And now, sure, of course, in China, I did find a bowl of rice. But I lost my body. I lost everything that I had. And the man who bought me offered me a deal, said, if I do become his sex slave, he said he was going to help me to find my family in China. So I thought, if I do sacrifice myself, I can help my mom and help my father. So he did rape me, and he did keep his promise. He bought my mom back from the farmer that he sold, and he brought my sick father from North Korea. But then my father died because he had a colon cancer from the prison years. He couldn't survive in China. 2 years passed. I turned 15 years old. It was 2009. This guy who bombed me was running away police himself, and then he somehow let me go in China. And as a North Korean defector, you cannot even get a job to washing dishes or being a waitress or cleaning the home. Any job cannot be given to us because police in China would capture us and send us back to North Korea. So the only place that North Korean women can go are either prostitution or to organ harvesters, because after all, our price is not even, we are cheaper than the iPhones, right? And the place I found that was, in my mind, the least horrible was this place is called chat rooms. In these chat rooms where we were forced to show our bodies and talk to men, and for this service that we give to them, they would give us food and shelter. So in this chat room, I realized my customers were South Korean men. And I thought somehow South Korea were colonized by America. I thought South Koreans were suffering. How do these people, how do these men have extra money to spare on things like looking at women's naked body? And then the lady we met in this chat room, she said she knows some Christian missionaries from South Korea who are rescuing North Korean defectors. She said, do you want to call this lady? So I called the missionaries in my phone in China. And I called the missionaries. I said, I'm a North Korean defector. I want to get out of this, but I don't know where to go. And she said, there's a way out. If I go to South Korea, I'm going to be free and I'm going to be safe. And I asked this person, like, what do you mean I'm going to be free in South Korea? Because I did not know what that meant. How would you explain freedom to a North Korean person? This missionary did a perfect job. She said, sweetie, if you go to South Korea, you can wear jeans and you can watch K-dramas. And nobody gonna arrest you for that. And that's how I comprehended freedom at the age of 15 in China from North Korea. I couldn't believe it. There is the world where individuals have a right to choose what to wear and what to watch, because those are the very things that we get punished for in North Korea. I asked them, so how do I go to South Korea? How can I go to be free? And she said, if you want to do that, you have to walk across frozen Gobi Desert into Mongolia from China in minus 40 degrees. So guys, do you know how many North Koreans made it to America over the last 80 years? Just shy of 209 of us. And I think I might be the first person came to Clemson, South Carolina from North Korea. Don't you think so? With that unbelievable like probability, I did survive the minus 40 degrees. I did survive the Gobi Desert. And I did make it to South Korea eventually when I was turning almost 16 years old. After 5 years of South Korea, I had an offer to write a book, to write about how I escaped from the Hermit Kingdom. And my publisher was in New York, my agent was in New York. So I came to America to write my first book. And then I was already in the middle of the university education, so I said, I want to continue my education. What can I do? And they said, oh, there's a great school called Columbia, it's uptown. Do you want to go there to resume your studies? So I said, sure. And that is how I began my education in America in 2016 at Columbia University in New York. I don't know what you guys have seen today, even on the news, what's happening at Columbia. When I got to campus, Columbia campus, and to the classrooms, I was literally confused. Like, did I somehow transfer back to North Korean classroom? Because the things that professors and students were saying were in a way the worse than what North Korea was doing. The anti-America, anti-freedom, anti-US sentiment was so strong. Like my professors were saying, the all the evil that we have in the world right now is because of white men and because of Western civilization. The only solution we can solve all these injustices is by dismantling the Constitution and dismantle current American system. And we build this country in the name of equity, which means socialism. And they even to say things like, you know, math is made up by white men to control minority. And I was thinking, my very lesson that I got in North Korean classroom was like, one day my teacher in North Korea was asking me, what's 1 + 1? What's 1 + 1, guys? Yeah, you should be more confident than that. I said two, and my teacher said wrong. She said, my dear leader Kim Jong-il at the time discovered that if you add one drop of water to another drop of water, it becomes bigger one. It does not become two. That's how he proved that math is made up by white people to oppress minority. And now at Columbia, they said, work hard is white supremacy. Being on time is also white supremacy. Math is racist. And I was speechless. What happened, guys, to America? I only came here in 2016. I don't know what happened. But the things that we chant, the things that we do not stand up for, have consequences. They say, oh, politics don't matter. In my experience in life, nothing matters then more than the political system that you belong to. Just look at South Korea and North Korea. I think in some sense, this got to be the biggest experiment we've ever done as a humanity. People who have same history, South Korea and North Korea have 5,000 years of shared history. Same genetics, same culture. They all love kimchi. And let's divide them. Divide it half. To the North, let's give them socialism. To the South, let's give them free market and capitalism. Let's see what happens. And what happened? 80 years later, North Korea is known for malnutrition, concentration camps, sex slaves. And one country that got free capitalism became the known the country of BTS, Samsung Electronics, Hyundai, LG. It became known for the world for the fastest internet in the whole world. So it matters. It's not that some people genetically are superior, they are gonna get a better life. It literally comes down to what political system that you choose and you endorse, and what kind of evil that you fight against. So I know a lot of people, you guys are in colleges right now, and it seems like it's just a show on TV. But I know America can easily become like North Korea if we do not steer from this direction that we are in. How on earth? I live in New York City right now, and my district is represented by AOC. It's an irony, isn't it? I escaped all the way from North Korea to be free and going to AOC's district. I think I was meant to fight tyranny all my life at this point. The reason why I love America is simply, it's tolerant. The AOC or Bernie Sanders, the so-called socialist, democratic, like, you know, communist, they thrive in this system. But in actual social system, if you say you're capitalist, you get executed. And that's what I'm asking for. It's not I'm asking everybody to become supporting the free market or any of that. Feel free to become a socialist, that's fine. But we cannot destroy the very system that allows us to think differently and have opinions, have different opinions. And that's why I'm standing here to tell you that socialism truly sucks. It might sound good in papers. In practice, it brought death to more than 100 million to humanity. Nothing has been worse than communism to humanity. So when you hear it, I urge you to fight back when we have a chance to do so. So thank you so much for everyone listening to my story, and I look forward to our Q&A. Thank you, everyone. Thank you so much. Thank you. I think we have 30 minutes Q&A.
All right, so now we're going to move to our Q&A. If you have a question, please walk around the back and come over here to my colleague Lofton. Dawson, do you want to start us off?
Hello.
Hello.
With all the issues facing America today, like some of the ones you mentioned with socialism, what would you say to American patriots who are ready to give up on America?
It's truly sad because I've seen so many nihilism in America, and it's truly sad. There is a reason why we are born on this earth, and there is a reason why we have to find meaning in life. And if there's one thing that is worth fighting for in my mind, that's America. So I hope that we don't choose to give up, and we do fight back against tyranny like our predecessors, like Americans. America did not become this great tolerant country, right? We had a lot of evils in the past, and we fought them back. And that's why it's a great country, because it has a capacity to fix. So I do really want them to study American history and don't lose hope.
Right,
yeah.
Thank you.
Hello. Thank you so much for coming. I was wondering a little bit about, one question I always had about North Korea was like in Pyongyang, which I pronounced that right.
Yep.
The people who kind of, wouldn't people who work in the government like be aware that in other places, like it's different? Like wouldn't they be able to see the propaganda wasn't true? Like why do you think they still continue to, I guess, perpetuate it? And I guess a related question is, you talk about how, you know, especially in an area where you live, like, you thought the rest of the world was, like, terrible.
Mm-hmm.
Like, from your story I've heard, like, I can't really imagine anything worse. So, like, wouldn't people imagine other places being like if where they currently lived was, you know, starvation and everything like that?
Yeah, so North Korea has a 51 different caste. And you know, the socialism that promised the perfect equality of outcomes, they eventually divided people into 51 different classes. And we wonder, like, how did they do that? We are a homogeneous nation. We don't even have, like, racial tensions between people. How they did that is, I hope it reminds you guys of something. They divide people based on what their ancestors did. So if your ancestor was a capitalist landowner, they say your blood is tainted, your genetics is oppressive, you're in the lower caste. If your ancestor was a pure communist that believe in the Marxism-Leninism, your blood is pure and revolutionary, you're in the top in the caste. So when you're born, it really doesn't matter. Like, your status in society already determined. Just like in America now, if you're white, you have to somehow feel guilty to the slavery that happened. Exactly like that almost method that America is now copying North Korea. So based on that caste system, like Kim Jong-un, who sits on the top of the caste, he does go to Switzerland to be educated. He exactly knows what the rest of the world looks like, how humans deserve to be treated. But then the people in the bottom, like myself, of course, never seen the map of the world. So it's really hard to generalize North Koreans, what they know, but just 99% of the people have no clue. And a few, not even like 1%, 0.1% in the top elite knows what's happening, and they want to maintain the system because in that system, they can be true monarch, like they can be kings. So.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
How's it going?
Hello.
So in 2014, I was stationed in South Korea. We're often given a briefing that we had about 3 days if North Korea attacked. And we're a lot of times we were told we'd be a speed bump. So it was pretty scary. Mm-hmm. Do you think North Korea has the capacity and will ever kind of attack into South Korea?
Oh, thank you for your service, by the way. Yeah, but I do think that's totally possible. They already invaded South Korea in the 1950s to start the Korean War, right? And that's what they're preparing for. And recently, North Korea changed their number one enemy to South Korea from America. So now they view South Korea as their immediate direct threat. So I do think anything is possible. And also because America does not stop this threat, North Korea's capability in their nukes, as you know, can reach anywhere in America. And so literally there's some day North Korea can start the invasion and there's nothing you can do about it.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you.
Hello.
Hello.
Growing up as a Korean American in America, my parents have always talked about what it was like to be a North Korean, like the North Korean story. Mm-hmm. And instead of seeing their life or their existence in like hatred or disgust, they shared like compassion and empathy, sharing how we all came from the same bloodline, technically.
Mm-hmm.
But what I'm here to ask you is, what do you think is the best way to show like influence, show some kind of support towards the North Korean people? And if that is even possible, whether or not they'll allow us.
Yeah, I do think there is a way to free North Korean people and helping these women in China currently. I am free, but right now there are 300,000 North Korean women in China are trapped and still sold as sex slaves. And this is a message that I've been struggling with. A lot of people in America think somehow the slavery ended. It hasn't. It's been continuing, and more people are enslaved than any time in the past in the human history. The only solution that can come from to stop this tragedy is got to be China. Chinese Communist Party sponsors North Korean dictatorship, and they sponsor this human trafficking. So if enough of us in America do raise this awareness, and we do talk to our politicians and hold our government's officials accountable, and when they fight back against CCP, I do think that day we can truly free North Korean people.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Hey, Ms. Park, thank
Hello.
You so much for visiting Clemson and sharing that incredibly impactful story. It was very powerful. My question is, All too often we hear American leftists say, when they look at North Korea and the Soviet Union, those aren't examples of real socialism. When you hear this, what are your thoughts? How do you respond to that?
It's so funny, right? Like, it was never properly implemented, right? It's been implemented 21 times, but not in one single time it's implemented correctly. So where's the guarantee next time it's gonna be done correctly? But it, and literally North Korea says it's a socialist state. And so I do think that just like, I don't know how they, just pure lie. At that point, it's even not it's worth it. It, North Korea is a socialist system where government controls every single aspect of your life. It's a government-controlled economy too, so they are a classic socialist state. Yeah, thank you.
Thank you.
Hello, Ms. Park. It's such an honor to see you. As a Korean-American, my mom has always taught me about the Korean culture through food and everything that she grew up with. My question for you is, do you have hope that one day that the regime will fall soon in North Korea? What can Americans do to help maybe push that along and get North Koreans the help that they need?
Thank you. I truly do hope it falls because that's the right thing to do. It's so sad. The potential of North Korean people has been gone wasted. You know, there are more than 20 million of people inside there. It is, in some sense, it's the biggest concentration camp in the whole world. The whole country is a camp. The only way we can bring down this regime is through CCP, because this is the one thing that people don't know, is that Kim Jong-un just is not a dictator by himself. There's somebody supporting him behind, and that's CCP. So if really we do want to free North Korean people, then we do need to demand CCP to stop sponsoring dictatorship in North Korea. So I really hope that happens, and we can use our voice to awaken American public and do choose a leaders that can hold China accountable eventually. Yeah.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Education system being mm-hmm. a really big influence today and the ideologies they teach, how have you been teaching your own children to combat these ideologies using your experience and everything?
Thank you. I have a 6-year-old son. One thing that I teach him is regardless ideology that I do tell him no. Because nowadays, the American parenting is like, no is the biggest taboo because you're gonna hurt their feelings. I'm like, the feelings needs to be hurt a lot of times, you know? And children do need a discipline. There is a good and bad. There's a good and wrong in the whole world. It's not all relative things. Like Colombia, everything's relative. So multiculturalism, there, everything is relative. There's no such a thing called like objective truth. It's all about how you feel. So I do tell him that we are resilient. Humans survived literally World War II's, famines. We all survived so much, you cannot survive no from your parents. And so when he goes to university, hopefully he does not need a safe space. He's gonna be okay with somebody hurting his feelings and offending. Other things I do teach him is reading in books, literally. I try to not let him watch a lot of the videos. I do go back to just the old parenting where we go back to reading books. And just everything that we did in the past that was okay and that did produce a great productive generation. And some that one day we woke up, let's do this thing over again and let's treat our kids like they're emperors. I don't understand, but yeah. I don't know if that makes sense. He's too young to six to understand it, but yeah.
Yes, thank you.
Thank you.
Hi, Ms. Park. Thank you so much for coming to speak to us tonight. Your story is so impactful, and I feel like truly Americans have no idea what people are going through right now in North Korea. And I was wondering, when sharing your story all across campuses, have you received any sort of pushback or censorship. I'm thinking kind of also particularly from the censorship we're seeing on social media platforms like Instagram. Have you experienced any of that when sharing your story all across the country?
Yeah, oh, I've been canceled by so many organizations, and one thing that really made me worried was when I was canceled by FBI. It's it's okay to be canceled by Harvard or Princeton. It's okay, it's a private university. It's okay even to be censored by YouTube or Facebook, Instagram, all of that. Still, it's like a private company. But when your national intelligence organization cancel you for your political views, you understand which side they're on. They are biased. So I was scheduled to speak at FBI, and like literally 2 days before my talk, this lady who introduced herself as like, I'm the head of diversity, and telling me that she needs to cancel my talk because of my political opinions. And I was thinking, there are just only 200 of us in America. How am I not diverse enough to be at FBI? I got to be the most rare immigrant to America at this point. And then so funny that week I became American citizen myself. And when foreigners, when immigrants become citizens, we need to take the citizenship test. And in my citizenship test, literally, no joke, this question came up. She said, have you ever persecuted anybody for their political opinions? If I said yes, you guys know that I cannot be American. You cannot persecute somebody for their political opinions as American. You do need to strip your citizenship when you do that. That means all the FBI need to strip their citizenship right now. Literally, this country is right now run by people who does not understand what it means to be an American, what it means to be a free person in a free society. And that's why we see that this country is literally committing a national suicide. Yeah.
Congratulations on your
thank you.
Hi, thank you so much for coming and speaking to us about your experience. I was wondering what most surprised you when you got to America?
Oh, when I got to America, I mean, like when I got to Times Square, I could not believe it was brighter than the daytime, nighttime at Times Square, you know? And it was interesting. There are buildings like Rockefeller, Empire State Building, Chrysler Building. In North Korea, everything is only glorifying the government. Nobody, no individual is able to compete their reputation. But later, beyond this prosperity and modernity that America has, what really surprised me was realizing not having a problem is the actual problem. That so many American, my friends in New York City, like more than 80% of them go to therapy and complaining how hard their life is. And the problems that I did here, I tried to give them benefit of doubt, like, tell me the problem that you have. And it's literally like, oh, the guy that went out does not call me back. It's like the end of life for her, and she needs to go to talk to a therapist. And like, oh my God, I'm not losing enough weight. You know, I'm going to this solar cycle and doing all this hot yoga. I'm like burning my calories, like, by paying somebody. And it's so oppressed that their food is too tasty in America. And I was like, at this point, you're like creating a problem out of thin air. It cannot be your actual problem that you have too many delicious things in America that's so readily available. So it seems that in my experience that humans do need some real challenges so we don't make up stuff like making up 10,000 different genders. So thank you, yeah. And for that, I've been canceled a lot. So thank you guys for not sharing at me, but thank you so much.
Hello, and Hello. Thank you so much for coming. So my parents immigrated from Europe, and uh-huh. We go back a lot to visit. Do you think in your lifetime you would be able to visit, or do you think that is a completely unrealistic expectation that one day North Korea can change in a positive way?
I mean, before visiting North Korea, I've been already killing list of Kim Jong-un's. So Yeah, that will not happen. They are already trying to kill me while I'm not in North Korea, but if I do go to North Korea, of course, they're going to kill me right away. So I can only go there when it's free and without a dictatorship. Yeah.
Do you think that could happen in your lifetime?
In some sense, almost like realistically speaking, if it lasts 80 years, it has another chance to last more than 80 years. But then I've seen miracles in life. I've seen miracles what God can do. I'm spiritual myself, so that's why I do believe in miracles. So I do hope that happens, yeah.
Awesome, thank you.
Thank you.
How's it going?
Hello.
So from my recollection, you went from North Korea to China, to South Korea, and then to the United States.
Mm-hmm.
Throughout all those kind of phases of you moving throughout the world, how has your concept of freedom changed, going from North Korea to China, and then to South Korea and the United States? I feel like you're one of the best people to ask about that.
Yeah, the definition of freedom, how that changed, do you mean?
Yeah, like how your like concept of freedom changed. So like, how did you change your view on like what actual freedom is and what it means to be able to, I guess, be an individual in society?
Yeah. When I in North Korea, I did not know the word freedom, so I never even thought about it. But in China, I thought freedom was literally meant you choose what kind of haircut you can have. You know, in North Korea, it was like a big joke for the Westerners that men are required to have Kim Jong-un's haircut. And that was so funny to the people like that. People don't even have that right to choose what kind of haircut you can get. So I thought of that as a little freedom in China. And when I got to South Korea, I thought freedom was, you know, responsibility, that you do have to be somehow responsible for the decisions you make. And when I came to America, I realized freedom is discipline, but also requires virtue. So let me explain what that means. I've got to America, and then so many people were telling me, it's a problem that we have too much freedom in America, because so many stupid people on the street can harass other people, shooting themselves with heroin on the street, like, and there's nothing you can do about it, because it's called freedom. And I literally had to go read all the founding documents, what founding fathers meant by freedom. At the time, they did drive the virtue from Bible, because it was built by religious people. But freedom without virtue and discipline, it's an anarchy. And that's what we are seeing. Because so many people does not know what it means to be free. What we see in San Francisco, in New York City, in Seattle, in Portland, is an anarchy. That's not freedom, what founding fathers meant. So now I see that we need that virtue somehow, somewhere that you can drive from, and we do need that discipline. And that's how truly a free society can thrive, not just people think they can do whatever they want to do.
Okay, so yeah. you think that freedom should be derived from a religious context and not like a philosophical context?
It doesn't have to be religious. It can be your personal moral, your personal philosophy. I think there are many great virtues in life you can drive from. It doesn't have to be certain religion. But I do think every one of us need a higher calling that is bigger than ourselves, and that we do need to find meaning in life.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, yeah. Thank you.
This is going to be our last question.
Okay, thank you.
What aspect of America makes you most proud to be an American?
What aspect of America? Oh, I mean, where do I begin? I wrote a book about this. I love America so much. I have to say, so when my first book was picked up by some producers in Hollywood, they wanted to make a movie about my story. And this Hollywood producer sent me a script they wrote about to make a movie. And in this script, it said, China was my promised land. China gave me refugee and protection. And I said, like, that is the definition of fake news, you know? And they said, this is the only way we can make a movie about North Korean story in current Hollywood, because they are all in the pockets of Chinese Communist Party. It's not that many countries, can someone like me, a former sex slave, can come here, not speaking? I literally learned English by watching TV show Friends. I did not have a fancy degree or fancy education. I did not have a connection. I literally came here as an immigrant. And because I worked hard and because this system was just, it gave me an opportunity to write two books and give a lectures like to you guys right now. America does, it is the land of opportunity. And this place can come, many dreams come true. And that's why I love America. It's a, where it is the most tolerant society that I've ever seen, but it also has the most generous people inside it. And that's why America is America, I think. Yeah.
Thank you.
So thank you so much, everyone. You guys are awesome. Have a wonderful day. Thank you so much. Thank you.